Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Mason Dambrot, your host. We're here today with Jesse Prinz, culturalist and neurophilosopher. Jesse is a distinguished professor at City University of New York in the Graduate Center. Jesse has a wide range of interests that hover around the philosophy of psychology. He is currently interested in the relationship between morality and the self, the role of psychology in constructing the world, and the role of emotions in art. Jesse has authored a wide range and an impressive number of articles and books, most recently Beyond Human Nature, published already this year under the Penguin imprint in the UK. Coming up later in the year is The Conscious Brain, which we will be talking about later in the program. And in production is Works of Wonder, The Psychology and Ontology of Art. To find out more about Jesse's interests, his affiliations, his publications, and his upcoming talks, go to his website, subcortex.com. Welcome, Jesse.
Terrific to be here.
One thing we're going to talk about first is your interest in and the influence empiricism, British empiricism in particular, has on your thinking. You stated that your theoretical convictions are unabashedly empiricist. So I was wondering if you could tell us what you find so compelling about British empiricism as it relates to your work in the philosophy of psychology.
Great question. I mean, as a field, philosophy has always been a pendulum moving back and forth between what's called rationalism and empiricism. And rationalists have always emphasized the innate aspects of the mind, the idea that the mind is already born with lots of information about the world. The empiricists reject this, and they say learning is a function of experience. We acquire knowledge by observation. We may have some innate knowledge, but most of what we know and most of what we do is a result of some exposure to the world. And I think that in looking at the human species, I've always been impressed by diversity. I think of all the things that distinguish us from other creatures, it's our capacity to be different from one another. And we see that cross-culturally, and we see it across human time. So you compare two humans at different points in history, they're more different from each other than humans are from, say, another species. And that radical capacity for variation suggests that learning, that experiential knowledge, is central to who we are.
That's a very interesting point, because it struck me while you were explaining that, that looking at other species, they do it, especially as we get into species that have more complex encephalizations, social species, higher mammals, there are individual quirks and individual behaviors. It's been said that bonobos actually distribute a form of protoculture. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, they're pretty much the same. Especially in less developed creatures with less developed encephalization. And we are all quite different, are we not? So then, would it be too much to say that you're anti-Cartesian, or is that a bit too strong?
Well, we all like to make Descartes an enemy in philosophy. I think that Descartes was really a very brilliant thinker whose insights about things like the emotions are very central to my interests. So there's much in Descartes I'd want to hold on to. But I think Descartes really overemphasized the contribution of our, he wouldn't put it in terms of biology, but our humanity. The soul is imprinted by knowledge in a way that underestimates the role of learning in human life. So I think Descartes is a champion of reason in a way we should applaud, but an opponent of experience in a way we should resist.
Ah, that's wonderfully put. And some of the other things we'll be talking about, I was very interested in what we'll be talking about later in terms of meta-emotions in the context of morality and Hume's discussion of secondary emotions. I was wondering if you could elaborate on that.
Well, for Hume, who had a lot to say about the emotions, there are interesting distinctions to draw between some of our simpler emotions and some that are more complex. And more complex emotions might include things like pride, where in addition to having a pleasure in some achievement or activity, there's a thought that comes back to the self. So mere pleasure is just a response to the world, pride as a response to the world that then carries with it a return to the self. And I think in thinking about emotions like pride, Hume drew our attention to the fact that some emotions have a very social purpose. Emotions like guilt and shame, various kinds of anger that we have in the moral context, are extremely important to human social life. And it was partially on the basis of this insight about the nature of emotion that Hume was able to go on and develop a very influential theory about morality, where he said that believing something to be morally wrong is really a matter of having certain feelings towards it. And that's a tradition that I've tried to uphold, to develop, to defend in light of contemporary scientific evidence. An important part of that story is the idea that not only do we have emotions about social actions, but we also have emotions about emotions themselves. So a very central part of human morality is that we can feel guilty about our actions, but we can even feel guilty about feeling guilty, or more often, guilty about not feeling guilty.
Oh, quite right. So then we can have what he might call, if I'm understanding this, a primary emotion of pleasure in eating a calorie-enhanced dessert, and then feel guilty because we know, in fact, since our doctor told us that we had to, we shouldn't be doing that, so we feel guilt about that.
Exactly.
And then we could feel almost a tertiary response of being resentful of the doctor for telling us that which makes us feel guilty about the pleasure.
Terrific.
So it's a very complex
great example. And I think this might be something that's special to our species. Having emotions about emotions in this very nested way is a testament to our cognitive sophistication.
This is very interesting. How does then, in your view, what the empiricist, again, specifically Hume, said and wrote, as it affects current thinking in cognitive science?
Well, I think Hume was a psychologist. He was writing quite a bit before the development of scientific psychology, so he wasn't using the scientific method or experimental techniques to study the mind. But like a naturalist in the Darwinian sense, he was an observer of nature. And for him, the aspect of nature that was most interesting was the mind. So Hume spent his time reflecting on thought, where that meant introspecting, seeing how he responded to the world, and using those observations to develop a theory of how the mind works.
Well, that is quite interesting. And I can see how it would definitely carry over. How would you, if at all, is there a connection in your mind between, no pun intended, between what Hume stated and what now has really been gaining in popularity or almost in vogue, embodied cognition and especially situated knowledge? Is there something there that he was prescient about?
I think he was very prescient on just these issues. In a way, Hume is the father, the grandfather of a lot of contemporary trends in cognitive science. And it came from the fact that he recognized that perceptual experience is a primary source of knowledge. And perceptual experience doesn't just include the senses, though they're going to be a central player for Hume, but also experiences of our bodies in action and experiences of the environment that we're situated in. And for Hume, solving a problem, thinking, reasoning, involves using this sensory, bodily, and environmental information at every step, as opposed to someone like Descartes, who says we solve problems by isolating ourselves from the world and carrying out a series of deductive or logical steps. Contemporary cognitive science has moved in a Humean direction. So scientists looking at the most sophisticated aspects of human cognition are seeing again and again that we use our bodies, we use the environment, and we use the senses to solve problems.
And it's interesting as well because it seems to expand beyond just the realm of psychology and the philosophy of psychology, that in fact any form of, for example, the sociology of knowledge, where truth is defined as that which most people agree upon. Well, that's kind of a family version of Descartes' thinking in a way, as opposed to taking into account the actual environment and using those observations to inform oneself about one's hypotheses.
Yeah, I think there's a way in which Hume was really a man of the world, and those who have followed in these footsteps recognize that we're really situated in both social and physical environments at all times, and those become very central to our thinking.
Well, thank you so much.